Hi kids, welcome back. It's so glad to see you guys. Welcome back to our third online service. Today, we are going to learn about how to truly repent and how God rescues those who repent and seek Him and find Him through Jesus. Okay, without further ado, we are going to have a time of praise and worship. Are you ready to shake your bodies with the worship team? All right, let's do it!
Help me to obey, Lord, follow me. like sinning. Right at the beginning, when I feel like sinning, help me look to you alone. Help me to obey, Lord, follow in your way, Lord. Jesus, give me self-control. Jesus, you're my
Father, that you just bless us throughout this time. In Jesus' name, we ask and pray. Amen. Well, we have something very special planned out for you next. It's a skit. So enjoy!
One day, Christiana broke her father's favorite cup.
You broke something. That's Papa's favorite cup.
I know. It's all my fault. I shouldn't have played around the table. Now the cup is broken and beyond repair. I'm afraid that Papa will punish me. What should I do, Peter? Should I clean up the mess and pretend that nothing happened?
No, Nana. You must tell Papa the truth.
But Papa will be very sad and disappointed with me.
You must always do the right thing, Nana.
Later that night, when Christiana's father came back,
Papa?
Yes, Christiana?
I have something to confess.
What is it, Christiana?
Sorry, Papa, for breaking your cup. I was playing near the table.
I told you, Christiana, don't play near the table. If you had listened to me, you wouldn't have broken anything. The cup was very precious to me. But it's okay. It's okay. I accept your apology, and I forgive you. I forgive you, and wish that you never make the same mistake again.
Sorry, Papa, again for breaking your cup. Should I go buy you a new one?
Don't have to, Christiana. You don't have to do anything to earn my love. Whatever happens, you'll always be my child. Remember that.
I love you, Papa.
I love you too, Christiana.
Hello, kids. Today, I'm going to tell you more about Samuel and how he became a great judge of Israel. Are you ready to hear the story? First, we are going to watch a short video.
Israel misuses the ark, 1 Samuel 4 through 7. The Philistines were Israel's strongest enemies during the days of Samuel, Israel's last judge. One day the Philistine army fought the Israelites and killed 4,000 Israelite soldiers. When Israel's army returned, their leaders wondered, "Why did the Lord let the Philistines beat our army?" Instead of praying to God for help, they decided to take the Ark of the Covenant with them into the next battle. They thought the Ark would save them from defeat. The Ark of the Covenant was the special altar where God met with his people. But the Ark was not a good luck charm. The Israelites needed to learn to trust God himself and not the symbol of God. The two sons of Eli, the high priest, took the Ark to the battlefront. When the people saw the ark, they gave such a great shout that the Philistines heard them. When the Philistines learned about the ark, they were afraid. They had heard about the problems God had brought on the Egyptians. Because they were afraid, the Philistines fought even harder. This time they killed 30,000 Israelites, including Eli's two sons, and they captured the Ark of the Covenant from Israel. A messenger returned to tell Eli the bad news. When he heard the Philistines had captured the ark, he was so sad that he fell backwards off his chair and died. Israel cried out. They felt as if God was no longer with them. Meanwhile, the Philistines took the ark to a city called Ashdod and put it in a temple next to a statue of their god, Dagon. The next morning, the people of Ashdod found Dagon lying face down on the ground before the ark. They picked up the idol and put it back on its pedestal. The same thing happened the next morning, except the statue's head and hands were broken off and found in the temple doorway. Only the one true God could have done this. God caused trouble for the people of Ashdod. They had tumors on their bodies, and rats overran their city. They sent the ark to another city called Gath, but the people there became sick too. The people of Gath sent the ark to a city called Ekron, but the people there complained and demanded the ark be returned to Israel. Many of the people of Ekron died or had tumors. The people cried out because of the trouble God brought on them. The Ark of the Covenant was with the Philistines for 7 months. Finally, they called their priests and magicians together and asked how they could send the Ark back to Israel. The priests and magicians answered, "When you send back the Ark, offer gifts to the God of Israel so you will be healed. Make 5 golden tumors and 5 golden rats, one for each of the 5 Philistine leaders. Put the gifts in a chest and put it and the ark on a new wagon. Hitch it to 2 milk cows that have just given birth and have never pulled a wagon. Send the wagon in the direction of Israel." The 2 mother cows would not normally leave their young calves, but God caused them to stay on the road toward Israel. They mooed all the way. The people of a place called Beth Shemesh, on the border of Israel, were harvesting wheat when they spotted the wagon and the Ark of the Covenant. They were happy to see the Ark. When the cows stopped near a large rock in a field, the Levites put the Ark and the chest on the large stone. They chopped up the wagon and used the wood to offer the cows to the Lord as a burnt offering. But some of the people of Beth Shemesh sinned against God when they looked into the ark. God's law demanded that the ark stay closed and covered when it was not in the tabernacle. God killed more than 50,000 men because they did not respect him. The people of Beth Shemesh were afraid. They sent for a priest named Abinadab to come get the ark. Abinadab brought the ark to the house of his son, Eleazar, where it stayed for 20 years. During all that time, the Israelites continued to war with the Philistines. Finally, Israel cried out to God. Samuel told them they must put away their idols and worship God alone. When they admitted their sin before the Lord, Samuel prayed for them and made a sacrifice. The next time Israel battled the Philistines, God confused the Philistines with a loud clap of thunder. The Israelites won the battle. God gave Israel peace as Samuel served as God's judge in the land. God taught the Israelites that he would never leave them. He also taught them to worship him alone. God won't leave us either. Since God is always with us, we should worship him and serve him the rest of our lives.
If you remember, children, in the last lesson, we heard how God was unhappy with Eli's sons, and he used young Samuel to give his message to Eli. God was also very angry with his people, the Israelites, because they had turned away from him. They worshipped idols, they were disobedient to God, and they did not respect God's laws. Again and again, they sinned against God. And so God decided to punish them. God used Samuel as a judge over Israel to remind them of their wrongdoings and to guide them to the right path. God carried out his judgment on Eli's sons as he had promised. Then he judged the nation for their idolatry by sending, if you remember, the Philistines. Yes, he sent the Philistines to defeat Israel. He hoped that they would learn a lesson and turn back to him and worship only him. It took many, many years before the Israelites finally repented and worshiped God alone. This led to a time of peace in Israel as long as Samuel continued to judge the people, bringing them God's word. We are also like the Israelites in many ways. We also sin and disobey God and our parents. But we are not alone. There are many examples of people who also made huge mistakes in their lives but repented afterwards. I'm going to show you a picture. Do you recognize any of these celebrities? If you don't, you can ask mommy or daddy who they are. Now, these very famous people also turned back to God and now worship Him alone. We should do the same thing. Okay? Now, children, I'm going to ask you a question. What is the difference between regret and repentance? Regret means that you wish you hadn't done something, right? Whereas repentance means that you admit you made a mistake and you sincerely want to change and become a better person. Now, my second question to you is, which do you see most in the world around you? Is it regret or repentance? You're right. Most of the time, we feel regret, but we don't truly repent. So what can we do about this? What does true repentance look like? How does it show in your daily life? I'm going to show you 3 steps, okay? And here they are. There you go. The first step is to stop. Stop and recognize that you've made a mistake. That was easy. The second step is to look. Look. Look where? Look to heaven. Look to our Heavenly Father and ask God to forgive you. And number 3 is to listen. What do we listen for? We listen to the Holy Spirit to direct our words and our actions. Okay, children? So, what are the 3 steps again? Stop, look, and listen. Very good. We should do this every day. And God promises to rescue all those who truly repent and trust in Him. Ask Him to help you to turn away from sin and to live for Him alone. Now, this lesson clearly teaches us about the need for repentance. The Lord graciously rescues everyone who repents and turns to Jesus, but we must understand that repentance is ongoing, is continuous. And that was what happened in Israel's history. It was a normal part of their lives as God's chosen people. And it's the same for us. It's very normal, a very normal part of being a Christian, to keep making mistakes and then to repent, truly repent, and ask God to help us every day. Now, children, I also want to tell you something else. We need to understand that God gives us many good things, many good gifts that we can use and enjoy. I'm sure you have precious things, precious toys that are very important to you. Or it's a special person. But we must always remember that God, the giver of that gift, or that person, right, is more important than the gift or the person itself, right? Our relationship with God should be the one thing that we treasure above everything else in this world. Okay, children, I hope you enjoyed today's lesson. We miss you all very much, all the teachers, and we hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.
So So kids, we learn how to truly repent. Repenting is not only saying that you're sorry, but it's actually changing your ways that you do what is right instead of what you are doing that was wrong. Is there something that you have placed more important than God? Is there something that you have put first instead of God? If you have, does that mean you should throw that thing away? No, it just means that you put God where He's supposed to be, which is on top. And the other thing, you just put it below, second place. God is an almighty God. He's such a good God. He loves you. He thought of you first when He was on the cross. So why should you put Him second or beneath what that you have idolized? Guys, kids, do you know what idolize means? Idolize means putting something first, putting something that's more important than God. Okay, we need the Holy Spirit to help us repent and change our ways, that we do what is right in God's eyes, not in what is right in men's eyes, or what our friends think, or what our people of this world think that is right, but we do what is right in God's eyes. So let us change our ways, let us repent. So I'm going to say a short prayer, and you guys can follow along, and we can pray this together. Okay. Father God, thank you, Lord, for loving me. You are such a good God that you have sent Jesus down to die for me. And God, Lord, I repent. I change my ways that I want, because I want to love you more, because you have been so good to me, Lord. Sorry, God, I'm sorry for doing what was wrong, Lord. And Lord, I'm going to put you first, Lord, in everything I do. And all God's children say, Amen. Oh man, it's so wonderful. Wow, time really flies when you're having so much fun. Okay, kids, remember to tell your parents to get the materials from your teachers. And also, if you have any problems, don't be afraid to ask your parents. They will help you. And even better yet, let them do it with you. Okay, so I'm going to wrap it all up, and we're going to see you together next time. Okay, but before we go, we are going to have a short time with our praise and worship team, and they will carry on. Okay, bye kids!